Shalom, everybody out there in YouTube world. This is Jared Jacobs with Cradle of Hope Ministries, and we're doing another Shabbat teaching. I want to first call your attention to the itinerary link that's in the description. I think it says something like Meet Prophet Live. This is our quarterly meetings that we have, obviously, four times a year, three times in Fairfield at the synagogue that we have. And that's when we all gather together around this nation, and some even come from outside the country, to be able to get together and experience the anointing of God and get to, experience the revelation knowledge that's coming forward. So I really want to encourage people that have never come to come. I drive 13, 14 hours one way to get there. So if, a plane ticket is something that might be too expensive, that's an option that you can explore as well. So if you're interested or want more information, click on that link and you can email the email address that's in the description, and they will help you to plan out coming to that quarterly trip. It's going to be April the 8th, the 9th, and the 10th coming up here in the next month. So what we're going to do is we're going to start a short series called First the Falling Away. And go to 2 Thessalonians chapter 2. Let me bring my notes over here so I can see what I'm doing. 2 Thessalonians chapter 2. Now, what? This is a very, very tough message to hear, and I try to put myself in people's shoes, because what we're looking into is, in these last days, in order for God to gather his people, to gather this remnant that we've been teaching and preaching on for years, and to train them up, that remnant has to come from somewhere. And that somewhere that we're going to get into with this series is the church, the organized church world that most of us have grown up in and we all are aware of. And that is where the origin of where these multitudes are going to come from. And so what we're going to do is we're going to explore why God is calling his remnant out of the church, and some of the issues that God has had with the church in order for him to need to start over in such a way. So please, whenever I do these disclaimers, whenever we do a new lesson or a new series, you really have to have your mindset. I was talking to my wife about this right before I got on this call. You really have to have the mindset that you are going to look at things through the lens of the Word of God and not through what you've grown up to have known or the environment that you grew up in and that status quo were acceptable. Because if you do not do that, what I'm going to say here today is going to sound so far-fetched and so out of bounds that you might not be able to receive what God is trying to give to you. All right, and I'm mostly talking to people that are new to this ministry, for the, watching this for the first time. All right, so you got plenty of time to turn to 2 Thessalonians. Let me go ahead and, do chapter 2. Let's start in verse 1. It says, "Now I beseech you, brethren, by the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ, and by the gathering together unto him, that ye be not soon shaken in mind, or be troubled, neither by spirit, nor by word, nor by letter, as from us, as that the day of Christ is at hand." And verse 3 says, "Let no man deceive you by any means, for the day of Christ, shall not come, except there be first, or a falling away first, except there come a falling away first, and that the man of sin be revealed, the son of perdition." So that's that falling away that we're talking about. And we've read this for years, and we need to pay attention to what's being said here. The falling away is taking place even right now around each and every one of us, each and every day, each and every year. And it's been like that for some time now. We are in this process of the falling away, the beginnings of it, and it's going to increase and increase over the years. Now, the Bible tells us that we shouldn't be troubled. It just said that. Don't be troubled. You need to understand that this must happen. It's a necessity, right? This is something that needs to happen in order for God to fulfill what he's going to in the last days. Now, from the 70s throughout even the 2000s, so you're looking at about a 30-year period there, people were coming into the organized church, different denominations. I'm talking from a macro level here. So the overall Christian church. People were coming in for that span of time in large numbers. But the problem was that people were also leaving the organized church world at the same rate. So it really isn't a building that's been going on. And the reason why is people are becoming dissatisfied with the organized Christian denominations by the millions. that dissatisfying that they have and that they feel is because they are starting to realize that what they're being told, what they're being taught, isn't working the way they said that it should work. And people are starting to realize that more and more. And this is part of that falling away process that needs to happen. This is what it's an opportunity that we have as Ephraimites, because that is who we're going to be pulling into this ministry. That's who we're looking for. The people that are dissatisfied with what the status quo is in these churches, because each of us felt that. That's why we're here right now. Go to Luke chapter 21. I have a lot of friends from the past, from people I went to high school with, people I went to college with, and they'll actually, you know, get on social media and they'll say, you know, I grew up in church, but it just, why is somebody calling me? It just doesn't feel like somebody is, or something is working. I don't know what that beeping is, but it needs to stop. Sorry about that. So people are saying that whatever they've been taught in the past just hasn't been working. They don't feel like they're close to the Lord as they were before, and they just feel like church isn't for them, and they're looking for other things, and they start to fall away into, you know, Egyptology, or they start to fall away into, you know, some even Satanism, or some even to atheism. They're finding out that what they've been told hasn't worked, and so they're looking for alternatives. All right, and that's the process that's going on. So you should be in Luke chapter 21. We'll start in verse 34. We're talking about people falling away. God initiating the process of people leaving the church in droves. Luke 21:34. And take heed to yourselves, lest at any time your hearts be overcharged with surfeiting and with drunkenness and the cares of this life, so that the day come upon you unawares. Okay, day of Christ, the end times. For as a snare shall it come upon all them that dwell on the face of the whole earth. He is saying, don't get caught up in the going into a different direction than what God is trying to prepare this generation to go in. The Lord God is calling his people, and I'm going to say this over and over because I'm challenging your thinking. I'm challenging your current belief system and what you believe God is doing in these days. Right now, God is calling his people out of the organized church, and he's getting us ready for this last transition before his son returns. This is the process that we're talking about. This is the process that you see each and every day. Now, in the midst of that great move, all hell is going to break loose on this earth. We've all at some point in our lives read through the book of Revelation. You know the seals and the things and the destruction and the turmoil, the pestilence, the economic problems, the wars. We know these things are coming, okay? But what we're trying to alert people to is that in order for you to make it through those times that are coming, you must come out from among them. And we'll get back to that, but I want to drop that in your bucket before we get there, all right? At the same time, this is one of the most exciting times because God is going to pour out his anointing, his spirit, upon those that have been prepared to receive that in order to do the greater works of God, okay, or work the works of God. Verse 36, all right, verse, same chapter, verse 36. Watch ye therefore, this is Yeshua talking, watch you therefore, and pray always that ye may be accounted worthy to escape all these things that shall come to pass, and to stand before the Son of Man. So evidently, we can become worthy to escape these things. And I'm going to say that again a different way. Evidently, according to what Yeshua just said, you're going to have to be worthy in order to escape these things. So there's something that we have to do on our part, because obviously the greater body of believers somehow aren't going to be worthy to escape these things. Only a few are, because he's saying, watch therefore and pray, because everybody's not going to be worthy. So you pray, you watch, and make sure that you're accounted worthy. We're going to show you how to do that through what we're teaching through this ministry. Now, you aren't going to escape these things if you're off over doing something that's outside of the direction of God. Now, historically, I want you guys to think back. Historically in Scripture, how did God alert the people so that they would know the direction that he's trying to take them? It was always through the prophets. We know that scripture that goes to you that have been around, Amos 3:7. that God's not going to do anything in this earth until he first revealed it to his servants, the prophets. So the prophets are the ones that are going to be able to point you in the direction that God wants to go. Now, I'll throw this in there as well. The direction that the prophets always pointed the people to was in a different direction than what the great organized church at that time, the Sanhedrin, the temple, the collective thinking of the people that were there was always a different direction than what they were going. If what the greater thinking of the people there, if that was correct, then God would have never needed to send the prophet to show a different way. And that's the process that you're in. All right, that's what's going on right now. He used his prophets outside of the organized church of whatever time or dispensation you want to look at to confirm what they were saying through signs following. All right, now, you know, Yeshua is saying that everybody that confesses Christ as Lord is not going to be counted worthy to escape. There's something that you have to do on your part in order to do that. There's nobody here. I mean, even for those that have been in this ministry, there's none one of us are guaranteed anything in terms of protection outside of the leadership of the Word and the leadership of the Holy Ghost. We're not a shoe-in. This isn't a guarantee. You and I have to put in the work because the Lord said, again, watch ye therefore. This is 2,000 years ago. Because it's a continuous process to make sure you're in line with the direction that the Lord God is going. Now, that's what we're going on. Now, financial turmoil is going to eventually come. Things in our government are going to happen. I mentioned that before. All around us, this is what's going to be going on. But the problem is the church right now is getting caught up into the being rich and plenteous and increased with good and I'm in need of nothing. That's what's taking the minds and the attention span of God's people that are in the churches today. He's trying to take you that way. He's trying to get you prepared for the things that are coming, but your itching ears have you consumed with something opposite of what God's trying to do. And it's always been that way throughout Scripture if you go back and you read through history. Okay? Now, a problem that we have, and you guys that have been in these different churches, denominational churches, I think you can kind of agree with this, that there is a spirit of partying that is going on in the church. You go to church to party. You've got the flag. When we were at this church that had flag wavers, when you would go into the service, it was kind of one of those new non-denominational churches. You were going to these services, and they actually had club lighting that was in there, like concert lighting. They would turn the lights off, and then they would get the flickering with the, you know, the colored lights. And they had, like, people that would come out and run around and wave flags, and they had professional band players. This was 75% of the entire church service. It's a concert. It's a party, all right? And that's what's going on. The Spirit of God has long since left being involved with things like that. It's just like with Ezekiel. You know, the church in his day, the temple in his time, were going through the motions of what people do in church. It was acceptable. It was right. This is what we've been taught to do. This is what I've always known to be correct. But yet the Spirit of God came out of the ark, hovered around the ark, and made his way out of that church. And as the Spirit of God left, they continue to do the rituals and continue to do the same things they were doing. That's what's going on today. The presence of God isn't in the churches like it was in the book of Acts. So in order to keep the people engaged, in order to keep them coming into the services to sit down, in order to keep the membership up, we've had to replace that leaving of the presence of God and the anointing of God through the signs and the wonders that we read about in the book of Acts with the flag wavers, the lighting from the concerts, the professional organ and guitar and singers that are paid. That's what we've replaced it with. And what we're telling you, go to Jeremiah chapter 12, is that what we're going to actually show you is this happened throughout history over and over again. Nothing is new under the sun. The same things that we look and we read about in Jeremiah and Ezekiel and even in Yeshua's day, and we look at those people and be like, that's so stupid. Why would God's people do that? You got this major prophet here. We're looking at it. It's Jeremiah or it's Isaiah. Or we got these books. You got these major prophets that are here, and the people don't want to listen. How stupid could they be? This is how we think. But yet, in the times that we're in today, we're doing the same things our forefathers did. The prophets are here, but nobody wants to hear them. So what we're going to do is we're going to go back and we're going to explore some of that. We're going to explore what the prophets were saying back then and look at how that's prevalent in what we're doing today. Jeremiah chapter 12, and we're going to start in verse 1. You are looking to be counted worthy to escape what's coming. And verse 1 says of Jeremiah 12, "Righteous art thou, O Lord, when I plead with thee. Yet let me talk with thee of thy judgments. Wherefore doth the way of the wicked prosper?" Okay, why? Why does the way of the wicked prosper? "Wherefore are all happy that deal very treacherously." Verse 2, "Thou hast planted them, yea, they have taken root, they grow, yea, they bring forth fruit. Thou art near into their mouth and far from their reins." So what he's saying here, what Jeremiah is talking about, is the unrighteous are prospering. The heathen, people that don't want to live right, people that don't want to serve the Lord God, they're doing very well in how they're living. All right, verse 3. "But thou, O Lord, knowest me. Thou hast seen me and tried mine heart toward thee. Pull them out like sheep for the slaughter and prepare them for the day of slaughter. How long shall the land mourn and the herbs of the field wither for the wickedness of them that dwell therein? The beasts are consumed and the birds, and because they say, he shall not see our last end." Again, Jeremiah is saying enough is enough. The question that you have to ask, you right now individually watching, all right, be honest with yourself. What is the difference between you being in church then the heathen across the street, or the person down the road that doesn't serve God? What is the difference? You know, I've worked with, over my, you know, career of being in corporate America, I've worked with Hindus, I've worked with atheists, I've worked with Wiccans, white witches, I've worked with Christians, of course, and Muslims. And the thing that you kind of recognize is, before I came in this ministry, is there really wasn't any difference. I mean, I served God in the capacity that I knew how at that time, but yet they're doing just as well as I am. You know, they're obviously working where I'm working, so they're employed. You know, they've got families, relatively healthy, all the things that they had. I mean, and once I was presented with the transition message, kind of a portion of what we're talking about in this lesson today, by the major prophet, and I had ears to hear and eyes to see, and I began to change the way I was living, started keeping the commandments and the things that we talk about, then I started to see differences in their life and my life. But it wasn't until I came out of the church, it wasn't until I recognized that what I was doing wasn't working, and I began to explore and begin to listen to prophets that had a different direction, but was able to have the signs confirm what he was preaching. And that's what happened with most of us that are here. The ministry, this ministry is challenging you to come out from among them. I'm not saying come out from among the world. You're already saved from the world. You should already be out from among the world. But yet there's no difference between where you are now and where they are. And so we're challenging people. Come out. Get with us. Learn what we're teaching. Do it for a year. Then go back and compare where you are now from where you were a year ago. That's what we're challenging you. So again, your mind, as a person that's been in church your whole life, we all were, for somebody to tell you, for a minister to tell you that you need to come out from among the organized church and to follow the Lord God in a different capacity than you've been known to do your whole life, your mind doesn't want to accept that. But yet in your heart, if you really sit down to think about it, what you're doing now isn't as successful as they're telling you that it's supposed to be. Okay, so again, come out from among organized religion, organized Christianity, denominational churches. God is trying to call the remnant out. That's exactly what he's doing. And he's giving you a shot. You're listening to me right now. You're being given a chance to come out. Okay, now was this any different? I'm going to challenge you. You guys sit there and think about this. I'm going to challenge you with this. Was it any different in Yeshua's time? You had the Sanhedrin, you had the temple, you had the Sadducees and the Pharisees, and these guys were the leaders of organized church at that time. And yet, when God said it was time to make a transition, he sent his son. Yeshua was there ministering. And if you wanted to follow him, you had to leave the church. They made sure you left the church. You remember the blind man when they brought him before the council and they say, man, how were you really blind? He said, I was blind. Now I can see. They thought the dude was lying. Didn't want to believe that Yeshua had brought the miracle to him that he had sight after being born blind. Asked the parents, was he born blind? Yes, he was. And the dude said, I'm going to follow after this guy, Yeshua. Threw him out. Paul went around arresting people that were following this thing of Christianity, following this Yeshua character. It's the same thing. In order to follow what God was trying to do at that time, they had to come out from among them. They had to come out from the church in their day. They were shunned. They had to go out. They couldn't go and meet in the temple and learn about this Yeshua guy. Couldn't do it. Weren't allowed to do that. They were shunned. And that's exactly what we are going through now. It's nothing different from Yeshua's time. Yet, we all look and we read the Bible and we try to think to ourselves, I would have never denied the Lord. If I saw Yeshua and I saw the miracles, I would have followed him and I would have believed. And yet, God's doing the same thing now. And people are saying, there's no way in the world God's telling me to leave this church. There's no way. Because this is the church. This is all that there is. There is no God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob outside of what I'm doing. That's what people are telling themselves. Meanwhile, the prophets are screaming something different. So again, why are the heathen prospering? You got these Fortune 100 companies. You know, we work for a lot of these big companies that are around. And a lot of the people, the CEOs and people that own those things, a lot of them are Satanists. A lot of them don't even believe in the Lord God. But yet, they're the ones with the planes. They're the ones with all the money. They're the ones with the houses. Why? Why are they prospering and God's people aren't? That's the question to ask. So this is part of why we're saying that there must first be a great falling away. In order for God to correct this, in order for God to change how things are now, he's got to start new. Everybody knows that God doesn't pour new wine into old wineskins. But nobody wants to admit the fact that the church is the old wineskin. God's not pouring into that. He's telling you to come out so he can give you something fresh. All right, you have to be a realist. You have to. You have to look at where you are when you were in church and ask yourself, is my life having the blessings of God? Not just talking about money, talking about, you know, all the things that are the promises that are there. Am I seeing the yokes being broken off of my life? Do I see the minister walk past and people being healed by the shadow? Am I seeing the handkerchiefs being passed out at my church where people lay them upon the people and the sicknesses and the diseases and the demons leave? No, you're not seeing that. But you're seeing it when you come to the quarterlies. Just like in Yeshua's time. It's time to come out. It's time to come out. The major prophets said this, the days are coming when the rain will only fall upon the righteous and not on the unrighteous. So when I asked that question earlier, why is it that my neighbor that doesn't go to church or my neighbor that doesn't believe or my neighbor that's a Wiccan or my neighbor that's a Muslim, why are they doing just as well or even better than I am? Because the rain is falling both on the righteous and the unrighteous. But when that remnant comes out, when that nation of Israel is being built and the 10 lost tribes are gathering, then we're moving closer to the time when the spigot will be turned off on the heathen. And instead of rain, they will receive curses. And instead of everybody prospering the same, it will just be us. But we have to work and we have to change and conform and detoxify what we learn from organized church and from the societies that we live in. That's got to go in order for us to be in a position for God to bless us like that. God's raising up his children to receive that time. The promises of God in the word are yea, but the problem is we haven't figured out how to attain those promises as a collective group in the churches that we were in. Haven't found it. Go to Jeremiah chapter 7. Jeremiah chapter 7. A lot of these cities, I mean, it's getting bad. The corruption, you look at a lot of these cities, and the governments that are attached to these cities, they're the ones running the guns. They're the ones that are running the drugs, and they're running the human trafficking. Why? Because that's where the money is. The wicked are prospering, doing wicked things, because God has allowed the rain to fall on all. But that time is coming when that's going to stop. And God's given you an opportunity to participate in that. But you're going to have to go through trials. You're going to have to go through temptations. You're going to have to go through a lot of stuff so that God can get you battle testing and ready to be ready for that time. You're not going to come out from the church, start keeping the commandments, and then, boom, you're going to get jets and planes and Bentleys. Not going to happen like that. A lot of you are finding that out right now. You're going to be tested, all right, because God needs us prepared spiritually, scripturally, for the times that are coming. All right? No different from the book of Acts. All right? But again, you have to be willing to take that persecution that comes. Yeshua said what? If any man or anybody will walk away from mother, father, sister, brother, for the sake of the kingdom, you'll receive more. Why do we say something like that? Because in order to follow him in his day, you had to leave the church, and you were going to get ridicule, you were going to get persecution, you were going to get talked about, you were going to get made fun of, you're going to be said that you are following a cult leader. All the things that happened back then are happening the same today. Nothing new under the sun. But you got to be willing to take that persecution, and you got to be willing to be strong enough to prepare yourself and to be taught and to put the stuff in your life, and the same people that were pointing the finger at you laughing because you decided to leave the church and to join up with this Ephraimite movement, they're going to be the ones coming for you for prayer and intercession when stuff goes brown in their life. And it's going to be like that. It's always going to be like that. All right, Jeremiah chapter 7, verse 1. It says, the word that came to Jeremiah from the Lord, saying, stand in the gate of the Lord's house and proclaim there this word, and say, hear the word of the Lord, all ye of Judah, that enter in at these gates to worship the Lord, gathering all the people to give them what thus saith the mouth of God. Listen up. Verse 3, thus saith the Lord of hosts, the God of Israel, amend your ways and your doings, and I will cause you to dwell in this place. Amend, change, stop what you're doing, and conform to God's word. Change, church, so that God can deal with you. Verse 4. Trust ye not in lying words, saying, the temple of the Lord, the temple of the Lord, the temple of the Lord are these. I'm bringing the paralyzation from what you're reading in Jeremiah's time to today. No, it's not the temple of the Lord. It's the church, the church, the church are these. That's the lying words that they're listening to. There's nothing of God outside of the church, the church, the church. Just like back then, they were saying, there's nothing of God outside of the temple, the temple, the temple. Verse 5, for if ye thoroughly amend your ways and your doings, if ye thoroughly execute judgment between a man and his neighbor, if ye oppress not, this is all the law, if ye oppress not the stranger, the fatherless, the widow, shed not innocent blood in this place, neither walk after other gods to your hurt, then I will cause you to dwell in this place, in the land that I gave your fathers forever and ever. That's where we're going. Behold, ye trust in lying words. What lying words did he say? The church, the church, the church that profit or cannot profit. So the deception in our political system and even in our churches today is everything is going to be all right. This is the prevalent message that's coming forward. You see it on television, you hear it on the radio, you hear it when you go on Sundays and your pastor's teaching. Everything is going to be fine. The financial system's going to be great. God's going to bless this nation. He's going to bring revival. Everything's going to be hunky-dory. That's what's being pushed. That's the same thing that the people were hearing back in Jeremiah's time. And Jeremiah said, that's not what the Lord God is saying. All right? People get all worked up over the fact that when this ministry, when we teach, we show people that the 91st Psalm, everybody knows that scripture, deals with protection, divine protection in the midst of turmoil. The 91st Psalm does not belong to people in church. It just doesn't. scripturally, it belongs to people that keep the commandments of God. Okay? At the time that that psalm was written, okay, that is what God's people were doing. If you, you know, if you were to keep the commandments and the things that the prophets were reiterating, then you had that protection. But yet, we've walked away from that in the churches today. You know, it's time for this message to be pushed out. It really is. And it's hard to really understand that God is on one side, his prophets are on his side, and yet the opposition isn't the world in this instance. The opposition is the church. The cry of the prophets in these last days is, let my people go. And instead of Moses yelling that to Pharaoh, or God telling Moses to tell that to Pharaoh, in the last days that we're in right now, God is telling the prophets to say that to the church. Church, let my people go. Let them come out so that they can learn to serve me. They have the prophets have always been at odds with the church. I'm not saying anything new. That's why I'm keep reiterating the parallelizations between what we're seeing in the Old Testament and what we're seeing today. There's no difference. The outside world wasn't just full-scale killing the prophets. It was the people. It was God's people. It was Israel. Who killed Yeshua? His own people killed him. So the prophets have always been at odds with the organized religion in those days. Didn't want to accept their message, even though it came from God. Didn't want to accept that. And it's the same thing that's going on now. All right? You know, people don't want to put up food. I'm not putting up gold and silver. What are you talking about? God's going to take care of me. This is the church. This is the church. It's exactly what they read in Jeremiah, the temple. This is the temple. This is the temple. Babylon can't come in here and take us over. What are you talking about? This is the temple. We're God's people. Obviously, you know Babylon did come in and take over. Verse 9. Will you steal, murder, and commit adultery, and swear falsely, and burn incense unto Baal, and walk after other gods whom ye know not? And come and stand before me in this house, which is called by my name, and say, we are delivered to do all these abominations. How is that parallel? Go to 2 Peter. Go to 2 Peter chapter 2. How does that parallel to today? Since the church is teaching that you do not need to keep the commandments of God, it's the same thing that's going on back then. These people, Jeremiah wasn't talking to heathens. He was talking to the nation, Israel, of what was left at that point in time. So they're coming to the temple. They're stealing, they're murdering, they're committing adultery, they're swearing falsely, they're burning incense to these false idols, and they still presented themselves at the temple and said, hey, I'm an Israelite. I can do this stuff. All I gotta do is come to the temple, do my little sacrificing, everything's cool, no problem. And Jeremiah's saying, no, that's not how that works. How does that parallel to today? The church steals, they murder, they commit adultery, they swear falsely, but we don't burn incense to Baal. No, you may not have a statue of Baal, and you're burning incense to it at the altar, but yet you participate in pagan holidays. You participate in Valentine's Day and Halloween and Easter, these holidays that heathens of generations before us actually worshipped. They actually had statues of these deities that they burned incense to, that they sacrificed children to. And yet, us today, we keep those same holidays and say, hey, we're the church. We're delivered to do all these things. Parallelization. Nothing new under the sun. You can't be mixed. I'm talking to you, those that haven't turned me off by now. I'm talking to you. You can't be mixed with that environment and yet expect God to count you worthy to escape the things to come. That's why we keep saying, you got to come out. You got to come out. Come out from among them. You can't do that. You can't keep Easter, which is a pagan holiday. Go look it up. None of God's people in the Bible ever kept Easter. Not one time in Scripture. And yet, millions of Christians across this world swear up and down that Easter is what is to be followed and not Passover. You can't be mixed with that and be counted worthy. Don't look at it through the eyes of modern society. Don't look at it through what sounds good and what I feel the God of love would say in this particular instance. You want to know what the God of love is going to say about that? Read this. Read the word. It'll tell you. That's what we're doing. 2 Peter chapter 2, verse 1. But there were false prophets also among the people, even as there be false teachers among you, who privately shall bring in damnable heresies, even denying the Lord that brought them, and bring upon themselves swift destruction. Now, we've talked about damnable heresies for the last 5 minutes. Easter versus Passover. Sabbath today versus Sunday. We're the church. We're going to vote, and this is actually what happened. We're going to vote, and we're going to change the Holy Sabbath from Saturday to Sunday. And when I go ask my pastor, my wife did this when I told her we were going to start keeping the commandments. She wouldn't ask the pastor of that church with the flag wavers and the lights. Nah, you don't need to do that. Sunday or Sabbath can be any day. Jesus is the Sabbath. So any day you choose a Sabbath is Sabbath. Even though they can't show you no scriptures for that, that is what is being accepted in the church. We're going to take the 25th day of December, and we're going to tell everybody that this is the day Jesus was born, even though that's a pagan holiday, even before Jesus was born. And we're going to sprinkle Santa Claus on top of it, and we're going to tell all the pastors that this is okay. We're just going to wave our wand and just say it's okay. Damnable heresies, okay? It's not what you believe is right and wrong. It's what the Word of God says is right and wrong. And that's the difference. You're not going to get that. You got to come out to get that. You got to come out. Verse 2. And many shall follow their pernicious ways. And pernicious means dangerous or destructive. By reason of whom the way of truth shall be evil spoken of. We don't keep the commandments. You guys know that. That's in the ministry. But again, I'm talking more to people that are new, watching this for the first time. We've been taught we don't keep the commandments anymore. We don't have to. We've been delivered from that. You know, the church, I've actually had one of the ministers, one of the preachers of the churches I used to attend, this actually happened. They said that anybody that teaches that we need to keep the commandments of God is demonically inspired. My wife knows what I'm talking about. That's the phrase he used. We are demonically inspired because we're telling you that God's word says this or that or this or that. That's what the church is telling the people. They're speaking evil of something that is good and holy. And the things that are evil, the church is saying is good. You see the parallelization there? You see how God is on one side with the prophets and the church is on the other? Honestly, step out of your own, I like my pastor and my first lady. It's nothing against them, okay? They're a part of something that has been perpetuated for thousands of years since Yeshua left. But God is over on one side saying one thing in his word, and the church is on the other side saying, no, it's okay. You got to come out. You can't be a part of that and be counted worthy to escape the times that are coming. Right now, you know, the prophets of this ministry, the leadership of this ministry are going to continue to scream, they're going to continue to yell, and they're going to continue to have the signs confirm what they're preaching. I can't stress that enough. When I was in college, me and some of the people that are here, we were in a particular ministry, and all we did was try to argue and debate with people. I mean, I literally would spend hours upon hours. It helped me learn a lot of words. But I would spend hours upon hours trying to figure out all these scriptures and go out, and we would argue and we would debate and we would try to convince people through my eloquent speaking of why what we're saying is right. But yet, it was never confirmed with the signs and the wonders as it was in the book of Acts. That's what's missing. We don't need to argue. There's no argument. You come to the quarterly meetings that we got coming up here, April 8th, 9th, and 10th. You come there and you hear what's being said. There's going to be some shock factor there. It will be, because there's going to be some stuff you've never heard before. Some of the stuff I'm saying here now, we're teaching the same material. But then when they call up for prayer, and you've got an ailment or you've got an issue, and God meets your need, that is the sealing of approval from the Father that what they just got through preaching is what he once said. But yet, when you go to church and the pastor says all the stuff that he says, talking against the commandments, talking against everything that we're talking about, saying we're the false teachers and preachers, and you go up for prayer and he prays for you and nothing happens, that is the seal of confirmation that God does not agree with what he just said. And I need y'all to grab a hold of that one. The truth is this, 99.9% of the church wouldn't even recognize Jesus Christ if he came down and sat on the first row and announced himself as Jesus Christ, mainly because they're looking for a white guy with blue eyes and long stringy hair. Yeshua, Jesus, is a black man. Skin of bronze burned with brass, or skin of brass has burned in the fire, hair of wool. Jesus is a black man. He's also a black man that keeps the commandments of God. He keeps Sabbath. He keeps New Moon. He eats kosher. He keeps the festivals of God. And he hates the abominations of men. He hates the opinions of man that have overwritten the things of God. That's exactly what he preached at when he was here the first time. You guys are teaching the traditions of men, Easter, Halloween, Valentine's Day, Christmas, Sunday, Sabbath, eat whatever you want to eat. You guys are teaching these traditions of men and keeping that more so than what the Word of God actually says. That's why the church wouldn't even recognize Christ if he came. Verse 3. And through covetousness shall they be feigned with, or we with feigned words, make merchandise of you, whose judgment now of a long time lingereth not, and their damnation slumbereth not. For if God spare not the angels that sinned, but cast them down to hell and delivered them into the chains of darkness, to be reserved unto judgment, and spared not the old world, but saved Noah, the eighth person, a preacher of righteousness, that's who was saved, a preacher of righteousness, bringing in the flood upon the world of the ungodly, and turning the cities of Sodom and Gomorrah into ashes, condemned them with an overthrow, making them an example unto those after should live ungodly. Remember these things. Remember these examples. That's why I keep bringing up these examples. God's bringing these examples up so that you can realize God does not care if you call yourself the church. He doesn't care if you call yourself a Christian or you call yourself whatever denomination that is or you call yourself a Catholic. He's looking at, are you living the way that I've commanded you to live? That's God's litmus test. Because over and over again, he said they will confess me with their lips, confess Jesus, confess Christianity, confess the church with their lips, but their hearts are far from me. That's what this looks like. Verse 9, the Lord knoweth how to deliver the godly out of temptations and to reserve the unjust unto the day of judgment to be punished. But chiefly them that walk after the flesh in the lust of uncleanliness and despise government, presumptuous are they, self-willed, that they are not afraid to speak evil of dignities. They are not ashamed to speak evil of the things of God. Not ashamed of it. Church, I'm talking about. I don't care about the world. The world's already going to hell. The world's already damned. The world's already going to have the destruction coming for them. That's a done deal. We're dealing with the church. We're dealing with people that have attached themselves to the Father through the Son, and we're trying to open up their eyes to get them to realize that God is not okay with what is going on. And he's trying to pull the remnant out. The remnant is not the church. The church is the church. The remnant is a group or a small portion of people that are going to come out of the church and to be separate and to be different. That's what we're after here. All right. Let me get a few more scriptures in here. Verse 11, whereas the angels which are greater in power and might bring not railing accusation against them before the Lord, but these, as natural brute beasts, made to be taken and destroyed, speak evil of the things that they understand not, and shall utterly perish in their own corruption. They are going to perish in that mindset. I get this crap on YouTube every single day, every single week. F you because you think the gays are going to burn. Jesus is love. He accepts everybody. There is no way that Jesus cares if I eat pork or shrimp. There's no way that Jesus cares if I go to church on Sunday instead of Saturday. Jesus is my... I get this crap every day. They are going to perish in that mindset. Most of them will see the Lord when they go before him. Okay? Granted, they don't take the mark, but most of them will see the Lord. But we're talking about here on this earth being counted worthy to escape what is to come and to stand before the Son of Man when he comes back to this earth. Y'all remember the parable of the sheep and the goats. Y'all know what I'm talking about. Verse 13. Yes. Verse 13. We get a couple more in here. And shall receive the reward of unrighteousness, as they count it pleasure to riot in the daytime. Spots that they are and blemishes, sporting themselves with their own deceivings while they feast with you. Having eyes full of adultery that cannot cease from sin, but guiling unstable souls, tricking people, a heart that they have exercised with covetous practices, cursing or cursed children. All right. That's not the heathen down the street. God's getting after the people that call themselves his. Okay. For they have forsaken the right way and they have gone astray, following the way of Balaam, the son of Bozar, who loved the wages of unrighteousness. We're going through these New Testament scriptures to show you, just like with the Old Testament, that the prophets are always banged on this stuff. God's people would get off into worldly stuff. They'll fall away from the things of God. God sends his prophets to warn them and to warn them and to warn them and to warn them. They shun them. They don't want to hear it. And yet God has to come and bring destruction. It's that perpetuating cycle over and over again. And it's the same way this time. Except with this, you know ahead of time that the stuff that's in the book of Revelation is going to come. And we're inching towards that time. Every year we get closer and closer to the things that were written about. And yet people somehow realize that they're going to be zapped off of this earth in a rapture and that they don't have to worry about it. If that was the case, why would Jesus say, watch therefore and pray that you be counted worthy to escape the things that are coming? Noah did not leave this earth. Abraham and Lot did not leave this earth. God kept them through the turmoil as it came. Jesus even warned, one stone is not going to be left upon another. And I think it was, I don't know, 70 years or so after Jesus died and resurrected, and people started to see the Romans coming, and the ones that remembered what Yeshua said and believed, they left. And 1 million, the ones that stayed, the ones of the church that didn't listen, didn't really want to hear that prophet that was speaking, because Yeshua was also a prophet. He operated as such. 1 million of them died when Rome came in and destroyed everything. Same cycle. That warning process, that alerting process, and that message is going on even right now. This is what you're listening to right now. And you have a choice to be able to follow God after with everything that you have and accept the fact that friends, that family, and that the greater church is going to shun you and extradite you and not want to deal with you anymore. But this is no different from our forefathers and from the stories that are in this word. I'm probably going to shut this down. I did have a few more scriptures, but I'm going to leave it with that. Okay? So, again, we're doing first the falling away. Let me put my notes down because there's a glare on this thing. Let me see. There we go. First the falling away. I don't know the donation amount on this. So you have to email the ministry to get the information on that. But we will continue with this. It is a hard message. It is a different message. But it's something that needs to be preached in these days and these times. So you guys have a great week. We'll meet again next week. Shalom.